Welcome back to the Young Turks. Another week without Cenk. I'm John Adarola, Anna Kasparian joining me. We're going to be doing both hours together.
Mm-hmm.
It's a big show. It's
going
to be a big week.
Yes.
It's cool, though, because you're going to see some faces you don't get to see nearly enough. I believe Wednesday, you and myself and JR are going to be first hour.
Yeah.
So I'm excited for that. That should be cool. We've got Maz Jobrani coming back.
Yes.
And a few other people possible for Friday. I'm not sure that we know for sure.
Yeah.
But it's exciting.
I'm excited for the week. I know Cenk's not going to be here. I don't know why. He has, like, business CEOs type stuff to do, I'm guessing. But it's exciting because you're right. We get to have some new faces on the show. We get to start and end things on time. It's going to be great.
Yeah. Yeah, though, I have to keep it real with you. I'm tense at the beginning of this week. So, I mean, we have the strikes in Syria. We're going to talk about that a lot. But now we... Like, any minute now, something crazy could happen. I mean, that's always possible, especially since inauguration, but I feel tense because with Donald Trump in the White House and his whims and his emotional outbursts, you never know what's going to happen. So we've got a lot of news to cover, but it's not impossible that we have to break that we've gone to war with some random country.
Right.
But anyway, let's jump into some news from around the world. Two adults are allegedly dead and two students were injured earlier today at another shooting at San Bernardino, this time at the elementary school. It was earlier today. We know very little about the situation. It's alleged to have been a murder-suicide, but we do know that one of those who were killed was a special education teacher. So another tragedy for a community that has barely bounced back from the previous mass shooting that happened there not too long ago. A new review of the bleaching of the Great Barrier Reef shows that two consecutive mass bleaching events over the past few years have affected a 1,500-kilometer stretch of the reef, leaving only the southern third of it relatively unaffected. So I know there's some disagreement about the actual extent of the bleaching, but we're talking about huge distances at the very least, where the acidification and the increased temperature of the ocean is starting to have a large impact. And obviously... you can't exaggerate how many species depend on the reefs for their habitat. Huge ecological impact there. Egypt has imposed a state of emergency following a series of bombings of Coptic churches on Palm Sunday across the country, both near Cairo, also in the north in Alexandria. More than 50 have been killed in those series of bombings. And terrorist attacks against Coptic churches are nothing new in Egypt. But I also saw some news over the weekend, late Sunday night. It was blood drives being done for the victims there outside of Cairo, people pitching in to try to help those who've been affected by that. So obviously a huge tragedy, also an opportunity for those in that country from very different religions to band together. And finally, following a meeting with the Chinese president at Mar-a-Lago this weekend, Donald Trump came out of the meeting saying that they had made, quote, tremendous progress on a number of issues. I don't know exactly what he's talking about there. Might be that he's trying to get more trademarks given to him by the Chinese government. The Chinese state-run news agency, though, declared immediately afterward that his attacks in Syria are, quote, the act of a weakened man who needed to flex his muscles. And so perhaps his prediction that they're laughing at us around the world is coming true with him as president.
So just a little more context into that. So the leader of China kind of was hush-hush as the situation in Syria unfolded, and then he waited until he got to China and he said what he said, and I was amused by that, right? I was amused by it because what he said, I believe, is accurate. I think it's an accurate description of Donald Trump and what he does. And look, we're going to delve into Syria very soon, but before we do so, I just want to quickly note that one of the worst ways to react to anything is through emotion. You should never let your emotion dictate how you react to something as serious as foreign policy if you are the leader of the United States, and that's exactly what Trump did. But anyway, we'll get to that and more in just a second.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see when it comes to China what tremendous progress they made. Certainly there are areas where he could do a lot of good for our economy, theoretically, or he could just try to benefit his own businesses that operate in China or those of his family. I'm worried that he'll take that easier road, unfortunately. Okay, but as you said, why don't we jump into Syria? Quite a few developments there. After last week's cruise missile strike on an air base in Syria, this weekend was relatively quiet. There were rumblings, diplomatic rumblings, concerning news coming out, but no further action, at least that was made clear to us. There are some rumors about the death of one of the Syrian pilots who flew the mission. I don't believe that those are confirmed at this point, but it doesn't seem like there were any additional strikes, at least against Assad regime material or bases. And so now we're left wondering, what are the next steps? I mean, they've said that there's likely to be further action. We know that Russia is saying that there will be consequences for what we did, but Donald Trump doesn't seem to be making clear what he's going to do, and so we're left looking at some of his most high-profile foreign policy representatives, and even they don't seem to know exactly what's going to happen now. So here we're going to have Nikki Haley, ambassador to the UN, and she makes pretty clear that there are going to be extremely large consequences for the Assad regime.
Is regime change in Syria now the official policy of the United States?
So there's multiple priorities. It's getting Assad out is not the only priority. And so what we're trying to do is obviously defeat ISIS. Secondly, we don't see a peaceful Syria with Assad in there. Thirdly, get the Iranian influence out. And then finally, move towards a political solution, because at the end of the day, this is a complicated situation. There are no easy answers, and a political solution is going to have to happen. But we know that it is not going to be, there's not any sort of option where a political solution is going to happen with Assad at the head of the regime.
But is it the position of the Trump administration that he cannot be ruler of Syria anymore? Regime change is the policy.
Well, the regime change is something that we think is going to happen, because all of the parties are going to see that Assad's not the leader that needs to be taking place for Syria. So what I think you're seeing is, this isn't about policy or not, this is about thoughts. And so when you look at the thoughts, there is no political solution that any of us can see with Assad at the lead.
Okay, so that at the very least is true. You don't simply have a political solution. They keep throwing that around because they want you to be focused on the political solution rather than the military attempts to solve the problem that they've already started and might continue as well. Obviously, there's no political solution without a military solution. That's why he's been engaged in the civil war for half a decade now at this point. But if you're worried about escalation of our conflict against the Syrian regime, I mean, she made very clear it's going to happen.
Right.
Now, devil's advocate, she could be alluding to the fact that if we can convince Russia, then Russia can take him out. Good luck with that.
Right. I mean, Russia has no incentive to take him out. Right now, Russia is one of Assad's allies, okay? Mm-hmm. And Russia took part in specifically going after civilians in this really brutal war. So I don't believe in a second or for a second that Russia would take any part in getting Assad out or playing a role in regime change. But the most important thing to take away from that interview was that Nikki Haley believes that the Trump administration is going to push for regime change. And so right now there's a lot of confusion about what Trump's strategy is, because he went from criticizing the Obama administration several years ago and claiming that Obama should not under any circumstance get involved in what was happening in Syria. And then he seemed to take a very, I wouldn't say favorable, but he seemed like he was very much in favor of focusing on America, not getting involved in the Syrian conflict. And then out of nowhere, because he saw the chemical attack videos, he decided, okay, no, we got to do something, and then proceeds to do, you know, the missile strike. So what is the strategy? What happens next? What kind of, you know, impact has his action taken so far? And what does everyone else in his administration say right now? She's the UN ambassador, right? But now we're about to hear from someone else who has a very different take on what the administration is planning on doing.
Yeah, so why don't we turn now to Secretary of State Rex Tillerson, who is going to disagree with Nikki Haley in fairly fundamental fashion on what needs to happen going forward.
Well, I think those continued actions by Bashar al-Assad clearly called into any question of him expecting to have any legitimacy to continue as the leader of Syria. I think the issue of how Bashar al-Assad's leadership is sustained or how he departs is something that we will be working with allies and others in the coalition.
Is it a priority of U.S. policy to get him out of power?
Our priority in Syria, John, really hasn't changed. I think the president's been quite clear. First and foremost, we must defeat ISIS.
So in terms of President Assad, you had said that there has been no change in policy as a result of this attack. So it is still true then that his fate is to be determined, as you said previously, by the Syrian people.
Yes, John, I think, you know, obviously the United States' own founding principles are self-determination, and I think what the United States and our allies want to do is to enable the Syrian people to make that determination. And we've seen what violent regime change looks like in Libya and the kind of chaos that can be unleashed and indeed the kind of misery that it enacts on its own people. It's important that we keep our priorities straight, and we believe that the first priority is the defeat of ISIS.
And just to be clear, before we go a bit wider, I mean, they're talking about whether it should be up to the Syrian people to decide their fate, which is fine, and we love to speak in those terms. But let's be clear at this point. There might have been a narrow window at one point where the Syrian people were engaged in an attempt to either politically change the regime, eventually starting the civil war, but not too long after that, just a few years after that, their ability to do it all on their own was taken away, and not just because of the brutal actions of Assad, but also the wide-scale intervention by Russia, the fact that they began supporting him militarily and also economically. So at that point, it becomes a fiction to say that the Syrian people get to decide. Well, yes, technically, against Assad, who is crushing them militarily, and one of the most powerful military forces around the globe. So technically, they get to decide. But anyway, there he's saying the policy hasn't actually changed.
Right, he's saying...
Has he spoken to Nikki Haley?
That's the thing.
Has she spoken to Trump?
That's exactly the right question to ask, because even within his administration, you see different messaging from different people, and you'll see them go on cable news, do these interviews, and further confuse the American people about what Trump's strategy, if there is any strategy, will be and how he'll proceed forward. It seems like things happen very spontaneously, and that's a very dangerous way to go about Syria, which, by the way, I concede is one of the most difficult foreign policy issues facing the world today. I don't know what the proper measures are, right? I know that what Trump did with the missiles last week was not effective. It didn't accomplish anything. If anything, it escalated conflict in a way that was haphazard and wasn't well thought out. But it's important to understand all the different factions that play a role in Syria. It's not just the rebels, Assad. Whose side are you on? No, no, it's much more complicated than that. There are, you know, various countries that have decided to ally themselves with either Assad or the rebels. Then you have,
Or
the terrorist groups, exactly. And so there's so many players here, and I'm not convinced that someone like Trump is sophisticated enough to understand the nuances of this civil war, understand all the players, and I also don't have faith in Trump in terms of uniting all the people that are supposed to be collaborating with him, advising him, and you know, essentially getting briefed effectively enough to make a smart decision. So right now, as you can see from these two different interviews, you have two different theories on how the Trump administration should move forward, and I have no idea what's going to happen. Everything seems very spontaneous, and there's no, you know, uniting front within the Trump administration.
Yeah, it seems like they don't know either. And that seems crazy to say, but do we have any reason to believe that Trump has actually sat down and spoken or gotten on the phone and spoken with either Tillerson or Nikki Haley?
Especially Nikki Haley.
We don't have that. Like, I agree, Trump isn't sophisticated enough to understand the situation in Russia, and he's not curious enough to find out about it, even after we've engaged with the Assad regime. And so, look, my fear immediately after the missiles were launched late last Thursday was that he will see this as a great opportunity to get us embroiled in a military conflict, which, unfortunately, the media will probably largely back him on. The people, the American people, historically have been very supportive of presidents during a time of war, especially if the danger of that enemy is hyped up to them. And we already know that in a recent poll, 51% of the American public supports the military strikes against Syria, which is not, those are not incredible numbers, and you're seeing a weird mix of Republicans and Democrats supporting that there. And that option is still possible. I mean, we could find out, you know, that we've sent in 10,000 troops tomorrow. Trump has said that he will not tell us until afterward when he engages in those sorts of actions. But there is a lot of danger in that path. I mean, something could happen with Russia, U.S. troops could be lost, and that's damaging to him too. So it's not impossible at this point that he'll take the small boost to his approval that he's already gotten.
Mm-hmm.
People saying that he looks presidential, and look, he'll do decisive action. And he might actually back off, especially considering how disinterested he is in Syria to begin with.
Can I please jump in with this whole notion that President Trump looks more presidential because of what he did? If acting based on emotion and acting in a spontaneous fashion without getting the proper briefings necessary from intelligence organizations is what makes you appear presidential, then we have extremely low standards in this country for what presidential means, right? Anyone who went on television and supported this and thought it was a good idea is a questionable commentator, to say the least, right? And look, everyone makes mistakes in their commentary and their analysis of the news, so I'm not trying to be too judgy about it. But I just want to be clear. Right now, what's happening in Syria and this escalation by the Trump administration will have significant costs. And who knows where it will lead? Who knows how many American members of our military will have to get involved in a situation that wasn't well thought out, right? And so this is not presidential. It's kind of like being on a high school campus and seeing a bully throw the first punch, and then someone says, that's what a real student does. That student looks like a real student.
No,
what does that even mean?
That guy looks student body presidential.
Yeah, that student body presidential because he took a strong action or strong act. Like, this is not presidential to me. Presidential is showing leadership, showing that you are properly equipped with the knowledge necessary to make a smart decision. And in this case, it did not seem like a smart decision. Trump himself said, I saw those videos, and he got emotional, and he made a decision based on that. Yeah. That is not presidential.
Yeah, well, it's easy to get away with that sort of thing when the vast majority of Trump supporters were polled, and they said that this is consistent with his past statements on what should happen in Syria. And we've shown you over and over the many quotes, both in video form, his 13 tweets attacking Obama for possibly getting involved in Syria. But this is the political context that we exist in. And I think that he is aware of how little memory there is amongst his supporters, how little interest there is in consistency amongst his supporters. Thankfully, our audience is a little bit more self-aware than that. I don't know where it's going to go from here. There's some rumblings, some rumors about further developments coming out today. An unnamed military official, so that's always a good beginning to a sentence, saying that they have now confirmed that Russia was aware of the chemical attack before it happened.
Yeah.
They haven't gone on record. They haven't presented the evidence. At this point, there's no reason to believe that.
Mm-hmm.
But that is now out there. Is that something that Trump is going to run with? Are they going to present evidence? I have no idea. It might be on tomorrow's show.
And one final thing that I wanted to comment on. I know we've gone too long. So I just find it fascinating that members of Congress did not make a big deal about the fact that they were not notified about what Trump was about to do, right? So Trump is able to act unilaterally if a country poses an imminent threat to the United States. We all know that Syria did not pose an imminent threat to the United States, but again, he acted unilaterally in what he did. And so if any other president, let's say President Hillary Clinton, had done the exact same thing that Trump did without notifying Congress, without asking them for their advice, their opinion, their support, I feel like Congress would be speaking or singing a very different tune right now. Okay, so
I think even more Democrats would be backing her up, even though a lot of Democrats backed up Trump on
right.
the strikes,
mm-hmm.
Elected Democrats I'm talking about. I think fewer Republicans would, but I bet some would.
I'm
because
sure,
it would
I'm sure
still,
some would. But there would
they
be...
still want that money going to the defense contractors. I think that that's one of the few bipartisan issues in D.C. Start a war, people are going to get paid. Both the defense contractors and then you through them are going to get paid. I think she could reach across the aisle with some strikes on Syria.
She probably could, but I just want to really emphasize how deeply everything is politicized right now and how polarized Congress is, or not just Congress, politics in general in the United States, but, you know, in Congress and the executive branch. And I just feel like Republicans would make such a big deal out of a Democratic leader acting unilaterally in a similar situation.
Yeah.
Just want to put that out there. I could be wrong. That's just speculation.
You're probably right. I mean, they did
yeah.
it with Obama.
Yeah.
Including Trump, by the way. Anyway, we do have to take our first break. Hashtag TOIT Live. You can send us messages. What do you think about this first story? A little bit more updates on Syria for you. And then we've got our final story of the day is going to be the incredible legal costs that police departments across the country are accruing because of illegality perpetrated by their officers. The numbers are amazing. We'll have that for you a little bit later on.
TYT is unique in a lot of ways.
I'm going to ask some uncomfortable questions.
Right,
I feel like I missed out.
So what is going on?
If I don't eat, my head's going to explode.
As I take my shirt off, just goes, is that your body?
Now we move to inappropriate story number two.
I just never felt guilty about masturbation.
It's amazing.
I could take partial credit for opening up your sexuality.
I was a kid in the pool with a shirt off.
Let's just call it what it is. I was that kid.
Well, you deal with the bitch that way. Right? But you're my boss, so that's what happens.
I think we're more likely to go with the shirt. They do see it from a frame of the rich and the powerful, and they don't realize it.
The last time that happened, we elected Abraham Lincoln.
I don't know, wouldn't it be wonderful if we unfucked the world?
You and I are disasters.
Don't stereotype all cops, don't stereotype all any blowing up like Dave Kohler on Twitter.
That's pretty good progress.
I didn't know you could leave positive comments. It's a very TYT thing. So you have a whole bunch of depressing stuff. So that at the end I can get the vote. Winning is, in terms of change and positive change, is not just possible, it's inevitable.
Great time to be alive.
But burn this mother down. Is that what you're saying? Fuck it, let's go do it. And that's why I thank you guys for being members. Because together, we got their attention. Thanks for tuning in, and as always, stay strong.
Hey, Al, I can't remember. Is there a specific blur we use for Miley Cyrus's butthole? Is it like a Gaussian or a mosaic or a compound?
I just closed my Wells Fargo account. I just divested funds from Wells Fargo. I definitely urge you to do the same.
Please, come divest. Divest today from all the big banks. Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Citibank, Chase. There are so many others.
Do it. We can make a difference.
Water is life.
Welcome to Nerd Alert, everyone. We have an exciting
exciting show for you this week.
Glad to communicate with all the nerds out there.
What's beautiful about geeks is geeks are open to everybody. That's the thing. It's like, so you got your thing, I got my thing. It's like, and if you're not, then you're a bad geek.
Why did you choose Battlestar Galactica? Because it's awesome. No kidding. The floor is not lava. Yoshi!
And there's one very special characteristic that many men have been interested in. Penis eyes. What's up, friend?
I know that curve.
And that movie is the Valentine's Day romantic classic, Deadpool.
Whoa, wait a second, Doc. You mean to tell me that this is a nerd alert?
That's right, Marty. We've entered a nerd alert.
Isn't that right?
How can you improve pizza? With math, of course.
If we spilled goldfish crackers on the floor, and we didn't want to clean them up, so we thought that if we stomped on them an infinite amount of times, they would mathematically cease to exist.
We are ready for a Wonder Woman movie. Oh, wait, no, let me correct myself. We were ready for a Wonder Woman movie years ago.
I'm Joss Whedon, and you're watching Nerd Alert.
That's what I'm saying. Never mind.
To we, like the U.S. might be soon, are embroiled in Syria right now on the show. But we want to read some of your tweets. One coming in from El Duende Chingon saying...
You're not saying it right.
I'm not going to go crazy. That's Jenks' thing.
El Duende Chingon!
Okay. There you go. Saying, depose Saddam, ISIS rises, Assad fights ISIS, depose Assad, seems legit. But maybe depose Assad, blankety blank rises, then you have to depose somebody else. Who knows? It's an endless loop. It's almost like it's designed to be that way. Tom Sherry says, unfortunately, it's very presidential starting an illegal war based on false evidence. That's true. So far, I am not in the camp that thinks that the chemical weapons attack did not happen. There are people on the left and the right with conspiracy theories. It could be right. If evidence comes out, I'll listen. At this point, it doesn't seem like it based on all the video and all that. And let's see. Dmore315 says Syria is a clusterfuck. I don't see any positive outcome for decades. Rather have zero U.S. bombs kill people so they're not mad later.
Dmore?
Just a handle. And I agree. I think that there is obviously a best option. I don't know what that is. And I think that even the best option results in a lot of dead civilians, possibly a lot of dead soldiers.
It's difficult. And the thing is, you know, when we're covering that story and I'm critical of Trump, it's not like I'm saying or supporting the chemical attack, right? And I think it's a difficult story to comment on because what you say can get misconstrued as either supporting Assad or supporting, you know, factions within the rebellion that are terrible. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's such a complicated story and it's so difficult to have like a black or white take on it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well let's jump back into it. It was revealed this weekend that Donald Trump might have personally profited from the missile strikes against an air base in Syria. Now, we don't know for sure. I want to make that clear up front. Some people are reporting this as fact. It is simply, it appears that he might have personally profited. Here is how. According to Trump's financial disclosure reports filed with the FEC back in 2015, thanks to the presidential election, his stock portfolio at that time included investments in technology firms, financial institutions, and defense firms, including Raytheon, a name that you might have seen in the news recently since they made the missiles that Donald Trump fired into Syria. Now, they are not the only U.S. company that produces cruise missiles. They produce these particular ones. Now, he could have theoretically sold his stock in the time between 2015 and now. A smart president would have, to avoid possible conflicts of interest, or at least the appearance of conflicts of interest. But I ask you this, does Donald Trump give an F about that? No. And they could present the information. He could release his taxes, he could do a full financial disclosure, and he could allay our fears that this guy might literally profit from the U.S. going to war. They choose not to do that. And we have seen nothing since the inauguration that should lead us to believe that he would not personally profit in this way. Now, how might he profit? Well, let's take a look at this. This is a recent timeline of Raytheon stock price. See that little uptick? Yeah, that was as soon as the market resumed trading the morning after the strikes. Now, people said that that represented for Raytheon an addition of $1 billion of value, which is true. Now, to be fair, if you expand the timeline, it's not like this is a record high for Raytheon. They had been sort of on the downslope. Now they're going back up. So let's not go crazy, but that is $1 billion. And if you look at five of the biggest defense contractors in the U.S., many had similar upticks, not all of them, and I did the research. I went through all the stocks I could think of, but some of them did. And for about four or five of those, it represented $5 billion being added to the value of their corporations thanks to the strikes in Syria. Now, he has Raytheon stock. He might well have stock in Lockheed and Boeing and all of those. And if he doesn't, or whether he does or not, I guarantee the people that he's close with do. His nuclear family probably does as well. This is one of the scams that they get to run, that they throw U.S. Weapons at Syria, weapons we pay for, they personally profit, and if it comes to the point where U.S. soldiers actually have to die, they're not serving, they're not going to Syria. It's a perfect racket.
It is. And look, as you perfectly mentioned, it's speculation to say that he has profited from the recent uptick in the stock price for Raytheon, because we don't know. He could have sold that stock, but I would counter that notion with the fact that anyone who invests in stock and wants to see, you know, their investment grow knows that probably the most stable stock in the United States is anything related to weapons manufacturers, because we have, you know, an industrial military complex. Like, we love the fact that we can continuously go to war. We have industries that continuously make money off of us starting wars, continuing wars, escalating wars. So I would find it hard to believe that he would, you know, sell those stocks. But yeah, who knows? He might have. So you have to be fair to him and state what the speculation is and what the facts are.
Well, I've been very clear on the record. I will not be fair to him.
Right.
But I will say it's likely that if we had all the information, this is probably one of the instances of corruption from Donald Trump where he profited less. I believe there are other areas, like the trademarks in China, some of the real estate deals, the hotel in D.C., the way that Mar-a-Lago is making just hundreds of thousands of dollars extra every single week because of his activities there. Those are far worse. But we bring this up because I want you to understand the breadth of the potential for corruption, that it's not simply in his business, like real estate. It extends to almost every area, and that is why it's so crucial for us to get access to his finances, including, perhaps most importantly, his tax returns. Now, there are a lot of people who have given up on that. We tried to get it, and now some are saying, why are we focusing so much on that? We're focusing on this because the potential for conflicts of interest are horrifying and worse than they've ever been. Every politician can be influenced by their donors. We fight that on a daily basis here at TYT. But not every politician can be personally enriched through corruption. Generally, they at least have to wait until they become a lobbyist or until the donations come in. But Donald Trump, every day that the market operates, gets the benefit from the corruption based on his actions. And that's why we need far more information, far more disclosure on his finances. And that's why we have to fight for it. And you have an opportunity, actually. In just a couple of days, it's going to be tax day. There are massive marches going on across the country for tax day to get him to release his taxes. I want to see those numbers swell so big that the media has to report on him, put pressure on him. Whether he actually releases the taxes or not, it can make him look like the corrupt SOB that he actually is. And that's why I want to see people participating in those marches.
Let me just be clear about one thing, though. I think that the Americans who are saying that we're focusing way too much on asking him to disclose his financial dealings and his tax documents are just conditioned by a corrupt political system. They're so used to it that they don't even see how devastating these conflicts of interest can be for the safety of Americans, by the way. If he's making military decisions and foreign policy decisions based on how he can profit personally, well, he's going to put innocent Americans, on the line in military interventions throughout the world. So keep that in mind. But also, look, the lack of transparency in this administration is unlike anything that we've seen before, because there's a lack of transparency in every administration, right? But keep in mind that he doesn't want to deal with the media, right? During these press conferences, they want to shut out specific types of questions. And if anyone in the media has the audacity to push back against anyone in the administration, they go ahead and, defame them as much as they can as fake news, as an illegitimate news source, this and that. So there's that part of it. Right now, there are watchdog groups that are fighting tooth and nail to get the Trump administration to do what the Obama administration did, which is publish information about the lobbying groups that meet with Trump in the White House. He refuses to do that, okay? Obama did do that, okay? Yeah. I didn't even know about it as he was president, but that's important information for us to know. Which lobbyists is he meeting with?
Yeah.
What interest groups are influencing his decision-making? So the lack of transparency is something that we should have expected, especially considering the fact that he decided that he would not share any financial information of his, including his tax documents.
Yeah. Now, I want to turn to one more angle on the Syria situation. This is a really interesting development that surprised me when I saw it, but we should not have been surprised. We should have expected this. Many Donald Trump supporters believed him when he said during the campaign that he was going to be a non-interventionist. He wasn't going to be a George W. Bush. He was going to largely keep us out of the Middle East and these other unnecessary conflicts that cost so much money and we lose so many lives. He was going to be America first. And then these Syria strikes happen, and there's the prospect of more. And look, I warned people for well over a year that the idea that he wasn't going to get us involved in foreign wars is absolutely ridiculous. It was a crazy thing to believe. He said he wanted to occupy countries to take their natural resources. So I wasn't surprised when he launched these strikes, but some of his supporters were. And so people felt, well, he might actually lose a lot of his support. But it turns out that they are masters at mental gymnastics, and they've come up with a way to not blame Donald Trump for the actions Donald Trump has taken. And wait until you see what they've all independently come down on. So this is David Duke, big Trump supporter, who said this. They're making war against Syrian President Bashar Assad in Syria and the Christians of Syria for the purposes of Jewish extremism. Trump's Jewish son-in-law wants to take over his empire. So there is actually Kushner and Ivanka Trump. So Donald Trump's not responsible for what he did. His son-in-law made him launch those strikes, and they just happen to be Jewish. Isn't that odd? We have the Daily Stormer, if you know anything about white supremacy, you know what they're about, concluded that the most likely reason for Trump to take the move against Syria was that he was being manipulated by Jews and the deep state intelligence community in a devious manner. So they haven't totally given up on the whole deep state thing, but now they've started to involve Jewish people into it. Let's see, Alex Jones, you might know from his show where he fights info constantly. It's them, it's his daughter and son-in-law who are literally enemies of the Republic. Jones blamed President Kushner for the media leaks from the White House, which he described as a jihad to go after hardcore conservatives and patriots. So Kushner is responsible not just for Syria, but also for the leaks. Now that one seems relatively free of anti-Semitism, but Jones also went on to say that the chemical weapons attacks in Syria were a hoax perpetrated by George Soros. And we know when they start talking about George Soros where they're going with that. And so look, these are different elements of white supremacy and anti-Semitism online, all coalescing around this way that they can relieve Donald Trump of any responsibility for his attacks.
Yeah. So, look, there's the obvious angle of anti-Semitism, which I don't think anyone really needs to explain to our audience. You guys get it. But what I also find so interesting, and I asked myself this question quite a bit, as soon as Trump got elected, how does someone like Alex Jones, whose bread and butter is conspiracy theories, whose bread and butter is going after the president, how does he continue on with his business model? How does he continue to remain relevant
when in reality, he's in bed with the president. He loves the president. Yeah. He can't get enough of the president. He's on his knees pleasuring the president constantly, right? Not literally, right, but you guys got it. Yeah, well, anyway, but... So he just comes up with conspiracy theories geared toward the only Jewish component of Trump's administration? Mm-hmm. Really? That's what you do? The guy is crazy. The guy is literally out of his mind crazy. No, but
it's all of these different...
I know, but David Duke, white supremacist, whatever. I mean, everyone knows he's crazy, right? Same with Daily Stormer, whatever the hell they call themselves.
White supremacist, sorry.
White supremacist, right? So you know what to expect from them. I guess the reason why I'm focusing specifically on someone like Alex Jones is because he somehow miraculously convinced some portion of his audience to believe that he is a legitimate news source.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that people are waking up and realizing that the guy is just completely unhinged, right? He's unhinged. And he profits off sharing these ridiculous conspiracy theories and fear-mongering, and also he's selling snake oil. Like, I don't know what other, like, penis medication he's trying to slang on his show, but the guy is nuts, okay? So he shouldn't be taken seriously by anyone.
Yeah, I hope that some of the Trump supporters will still realize what's going on. I mean, we've seen on Reddit, some of the Donald Trump supporting forums are saying, well, like, he said he wouldn't do this, and now he's doing it. And when they sold out to the ISPs to give them your private browsing information, they seem to be waking up a little bit. But those whose business model is going along with conspiracy theories, I assume that they would have perhaps some cognitive dissonance over the fact that they now have to support everything the federal government does. But if you can come up with secret societies and cabals inside of the White House, if you can all put it off on these subversive elements that you make up, then you can keep making money. And so I should have had more respect for how flexible these broken minds are.
Respect, but again, is not the right word to use in this context. But
I'm using it ironically.
Yeah.
My fear is that I don't like to see the continued anti-Semitism. I know some people want to distract you away from that, but that seems to be a constant throughout the campaign and into now. It's a scary part of politics throughout our history. It's a scary part of U.S. politics. I don't like to see it continuing to this point. But anyway, so just be on the lookout. When you start to hear that things aren't Trump's fault, that it's something, someone else operating inside of the White House, it could be that people are just trying to relieve themselves of some awkward, uncomfortable cognitive dissonance.
How does Trump feel about the fact that all of these supporters believe that he's being manipulated, that he's so mentally weak and intellectually challenged that he's being manipulated by Jared Kushner? I don't know. How does Trump feel about it?
I don't know. We should poll the audience. But anyway, we do have to take one more short little break. When we come back, we've got a very shocking video of some police brutality against a young woman in Colorado. And then we're going to break down what people, citizens around the U.S., are paying to cover up for the crimes of police officers in some of the biggest cities across America. We'll have that for you after this break.
We talk about TYT Army being so strong. Usually they help us run our show. Now they're going to help us run the country.
Oh, yeah.
Like this. It's time that we reclaim democracy for the people.
We had a huge victory for Wolfpack.
When Lincoln said this was a country by, of, and for, he said of the people, not of corporations.
Our representatives don't represent us. Whoa! Democracy!
United!
We are! Too strong!
There's thousands of volunteers, and you can be among them.
With Wolfpack, the mission is so clear.
Money is killing our democracy.
96% of Americans want it.
When you get the power back, oh, that feels good. This is just the beginning. Let's go get them, man. Up and at them. Knock, knock.
We're coming for them!
Wolf-pack.com.
They'd rather lose to Republicans than have a progressive win with them. That's how dumb the corporate Democrats are.
The Democrats who voted the seat, and at the end of the day, they're the ones who pushed the right-wing agenda. Most of the people are either unemployed, underemployed, or fucked.
This is why you lost the Trump, you fucking moron.
What the fuck?
You
one hand and going like this.
The Democrats are dead. The way you feel right now, that's how a chump feels.
That freaked out.
Welcome back to CYC Sports. Jason and Francis here.
This is where everybody has to listen.
Jason here, welcome to CYC Sports, Turks and Jerks, CYC Sports.
Steph Curry signed with Under Armour.
Tom Brady's mad, by the way.
Can you hear me?
Why don't you like me fall?
Actually, no, look at the description box below instead of lying about me.
Description box below.
And if you throw up another picture of the UK bacon,
I don't know. And if I throw it all,
Show everybody a couple tweets for you, and then we're going to get into breaking down what's going on with the police. It's a topic that is all too often forgotten in the reign of Donald Trump. Let's see. Talking about some of the topics we just got done discussing, Rahm L.J. Guzman says, there are cities without clean water. Millions of Americans don't have health care. Education is a privilege. The U.S. has problems. It does. It does, however, have 59 fewer cruise missiles, although it will be buying replacements, don't worry. It has money for that. Let's see. Javier Ortiz says, give a child a new toy and they'll want to use it. Honestly, I'm surprised it took this long talking about the missile strikes.
Are you going out of your way to mispronounce Latino names today?
What did I say?
It's Guzman and Ortiz.
What did I say?
Ortiz. And
oh, sorry. Okay, sorry. I have it's my dental work. I swear. I just got a crown
okay.
Put in.
I'm just like, because I know you know how to pronounce those names. I've heard you say them before.
Just so. Calm down and off.
Okay, I'm sorry. Okay? I just want to do justice to my Latino brothers and sisters. Okay, that's all I'm saying.
It's Latino, first of all. Okay. And then somebody. Oh, that's true. Oh, that's true. I'm not even getting that. So Marty Rosie. It's Marty Rosie, okay?
Okay, got
That's
it.
That's what it is.
You got the white
anyway,
name.
Marty Rosie agrees with one of you. I see what you're saying. agrees with the point that you made in the last segment, saying Trump is a grown man. He should be able to make his own decisions. How can someone respect a man so easily influenced?
I agree, yeah.
I don't know, man. The human mind is an amazing thing, not for the reasons it should be, but for people's ability to twist it and contort it to never have to rethink the things you already think. Like, I have a feeling about this person, I don't want to change it, it would be exhausting, I have a hard job, my relationship sucks, just let me keep liking Donald Trump.
But it's so much harder to, like, find weird twists and turns in order to support your preconceived notions. I think it's a lot easier than people realize to just be like, huh, this is new information that goes against what I previously thought. Maybe I need to reform what I think, you know?
No.
Or evolve, in my opinion. No. Like, that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that.
No, you're weak. You're weak, damn it. You gotta be consistent.
Yeah, we're freaking monkeys, man.
Never rethink things. Yeah. Never change. Okay, let's jump into something pretty serious. We've got some very disturbing footage for you. So this is cell phone video of a 22-year-old college student named Michaela Surratt being just devastated, brutalized by police in Colorado Springs. I believe this is earlier this week. Let's take a look. That video was made available by Barstool Sports, someone who was witnessing an ongoing altercation between that woman, Michaela, and her boyfriend and the police and a bouncer taking it. Now, many people, either the videotaper or the people around, laughing. It's not a laughing matter. That is about as serious a damaging act as you can take. Now, the police are going to say that you don't see the context. You don't know what happened before that video. But we also wouldn't have seen anything if not for that video. And so we know how these situations normally go when someone doesn't take their cell phone out. The police say she was being resistant. We had to do this. No one would really believe how devastating that body slam was. But you saw it now. There's no excuse for that. She didn't have a machine gun in her hand. I wouldn't do that to my worst enemy.
So she was allegedly attempting to break up a fight between her boyfriend and some other guy. And apparently that's when cops got involved. Cops say that they had told her that she could leave at that moment, but she didn't want to leave. And I'm going to be absolutely honest, if I were in that situation, if I were in her shoes, and I experienced my significant other in some sort of physical altercation, I'm not going to leave, right? I'm going to stay there and make sure he's okay. So I don't blame her for not leaving. The cops are right. We don't see too much of what happened prior to the video, but
they say that she shoulder checked a bouncer.
Oh, she shoulder checked the bouncer. Did she shoulder check the cop? And was the cop facing an imminent threat there to the point where he had to slam her to the floor like that?
We saw her.
No.
Is her shoulder check an imminent threat to your life?
No. Her, she's a very thin young woman, okay, and even in that situation with the cop where there's a little bit of a back and forth, the cop isn't even really struggling with her. That's the amazing part. He lost his temper real quick.
Yeah.
And so I'm furious at whoever's in the background laughing at it as if it's like some entertainment, form of entertainment for that person. That is a human being who could have really gotten seriously and permanently hurt as a result of that.
Yeah.
And I'm also angry at the way that the cop handled it. Okay, if she is being, I can't even watch it, to be honest with you. Like, it's difficult to watch.
It's just brutal.
Sorry, guys. I can't watch it anymore. But every single time I do look at it, I'm just like, what made that cop think that that needed to be, you know, the end result? I mean, if she's being difficult,
apparently that's the culture.
That could have been handled in so many other ways, and he could have restrained her in so many other ways. I'm so happy that she's not, you know, paralyzed from maybe breaking her neck or getting a concussion.
It's not impossible you could have died.
Exactly.
Now we have a statement from the police. So this is a Fort Collins police chief saying, as with most events of this type, the short publicly available video does not have the context or content of the full event. Additionally, rarely in use of force situations is there agreement from all the parties involved as to the appropriateness, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, that's true. We might disagree from time to time when we see some video. I think every human being on earth can agree that there's no way that that's appropriate. If she had just whispered into his ear, I am a chemical bomb about to explode, okay, you can slam her. Aside from that, anything operating inside of the bounds of reality, no, that was not appropriate. He also, by the way, said this. Now, the question would be, they have body cameras, apparently. That's great. So body cameras are good. You can get more context. The Chief Hutto said that there are police body camera videos of the incident, but he will not release them because the incident is still under investigation. Okay, well then spare us the you guys don't have all the context, you haven't seen everything. If you have the video and you can show it to us, and It makes your cop look better as a result. The fact that you're hiding it seems just a little bit suspicious at this point.
Yeah, I agree.
And then that's a quick reminder that while I think that the spread of body cameras is a good thing, and it will lead to slightly more justice, it is by no means a solution to all the problems we have with police, especially considering that police all too often either don't release the video footage, or the camera's accidentally turned off, or it breaks. Apparently, if you jostle it, they break pretty easily. That's something that we have to be on the lookout for. But that was unconscionable what happened to that woman. Anyway, let's go a little bit broader now. Police misconduct around the country is costing cities huge sums of money every single year, and the settlements are only getting bigger and more numerous as the years actually pass. So the LA Times had a great breakdown of some of the recent settlements here just in LA. The county's annual payouts because of misconduct have jumped from $5.6 million to nearly $51 million during just the last 5 years. A gigantic leap. Because of illegal acts taken by police. So $51 million is a lot of money, and you might think, well, how can the police afford to pay that? Well, they can afford to pay that because they're not paying that. If you live in LA, if you're paying taxes, you're paying for that. Now, how does this actually break down? How do you get to $51 million? Well, $6 million went to a woman who had been raped by a sheriff's deputy during a traffic stop. $7 million resolved multiple lawsuits after deputies in West Hollywood mistakenly shot two hostages, killing one and seriously wounding the other. And then there's a variety of other settlements having to do with sexual assault, excessive force, shooting unarmed suspects, and wrongful imprisonment. Now, some of these things are going to happen in a city of this many police, this many people. Hostages do occasionally get shot. These are tense situations. But I believe you reported on that situation. They apparently went in guns blazing. They shot up the car with a couple of women thinking it was a suspect at some point. It's this sort of just crazy behavior, shooting before thinking, and having very little accountability that ends up costing the city $51 million in addition to all the lives lost.
Right. So I think oftentimes when we talk about the issue of better police training and police brutality, what happens is we will look at one very specific case of a specific person who was shot and killed, an unarmed individual, whether it's Walter Scott or Tamir Rice. We'll look at that case and exactly. We'll immediately judge the individual who was shot and killed. And so the conversation isn't really about a broader context and what we're seeing among police throughout the country. And the reality is, regardless of what you care about, let's say you don't care about these victims at all and you think that they're all so-called thugs and criminals and they all deserve to be shot and killed even if they were unarmed. Okay, we'll take that part out of it and focus on how this type of behavior personally affects you. This is your taxpayer money, okay? So when these cases need to be adjudicated, when these settlements need to be paid out, when these judgments are read and these police departments have to pay whatever the judge decides is the proper amount that the victims deserve, that is your money. It is not the cops, right? And so I'm not going to sit here and say all these cops are terrible. And so, you know, no, that's not what I'm trying to say at all. What I'm trying to say is bad police behavior and a lack of effective training affects every single one of us, regardless of what our race is, regardless of what our socioeconomic status is. And that's why it's important that we hone in on this issue and find real solutions. If we see bad behavior and we know that that bad behavior is accurate, like it's reported accurately and we have evidence for it, there needs to be proper consequences and we need to train them better. There needs to be a little more hesitation before shots are fired. And right now, it seems like there's no hesitation at all. I mean, a cop raped someone and the county had to pay $6 million. $6 million, that's our money.
And that's just one of the sexual assaults that were settled in LA. And so, as you point out, this affects everybody. It also affects every city, basically. This is not just an LA problem. So LA Times did a great job getting that information, but then I cast a wider net. I looked for evidence from around the country, and I found it. This is a growing problem. Let's see. New York City spent $228.5 million settling police misconduct lawsuits just in 2016. That works out to $27 for every single New Yorker. Washington, D.C. paid at least $31.6 million in court judgments or settlements since 2005. And the Chicago Sun-Times reported back in 2014 that the city had already paid out nearly half a billion dollars in settlements over the past decade. That's not including 2015 and 2016, and I think you can think of some legal troubles with the police in Chicago in those years. So this is a problem that goes from big cities to small. The numbers for Baltimore were incredibly high. This is affecting your, if you're in a city, it's affecting your state if not. And there are ways we can deal with this. And if we reform the way that police are trained, we don't just get more justice on a daily basis. We don't just stop people from being killed unnecessarily. We can also save an incredible amount of money that can be reinvested into communities and can produce a lot of good over time.
The whole point of having police is to go after the bad guys, protect the good guys. Not to have the cops act as the bad guys,
exactly.
And then have us foot the bill as a result.
Exactly. Yeah, these numbers are just ridiculous, but there is something we can do about it. Unfortunately, we're unlikely to get any help at the federal level in the next few years. We know what Jeff Sessions is, we know what he represents, but it's still possible to change things at a local level, certainly at a state level, and you can ward off some of these unnecessary crimes and the settlements by doing that. Now we're going to break in just a little bit over a minute to go to the second hour. Before you tease a couple of stories, I just want to thank two of our members. I want to give them some shout-outs. Really worried about the pronunciation now, I'm not going to lie to you.
Sorry!
So, member Lydia Trailovic.
That
sounds reasonable.
Sounds pretty good.
Thank you for being a member. And Gina Mignola. Thank you for your membership. It's incredibly important, especially during these days of YouTube apocalypse. You being members allows us to be both independent and also to weather ridiculous storms in the policies of YouTube from time to time. So what can we look forward to in the next hour?
I am going to share an interaction that I had with a young troll on Instagram.
I don't know about this.
Yes, it's entertaining and... Oh, I'm going to actually ask you guys for advice. I think it's important. So
you're going to continue this confrontation going forward?
Possibly.
Okay.
Based on the advice that our members give me. You don't want to miss the details on that.
Okay, and I know that you're also excited. You've got a block breaking down Bill O'Reilly's troubles and also some ways that he's apparently benefiting from being in the spotlight again.
It's absurd.
It's ridiculous how the system works. But it turns out it's good to be rich and powerful.
Yeah, it turns out. Weird.
Works out pretty well.
Weird.
Yeah. So with that, continue to tweet us at hashtag TYTLive, both about the stories we covered in the first hour today, also what you'd like to see discussed on the show tomorrow, and we'll be back right after this break. Today is truly a historic day with the Supreme Court decision that makes same-sex marriage legal nationwide.
So this is one of those days in American history, it doesn't come along that often, where we have expanded the circle of liberty.
Look, all we try to do on this show, okay, is to give you perspectives, right? So you can get a better understanding.
We need to change our mentality and understand why these people are trying to leave their own countries and everything that they've known, everything that they've built.
Yeah.
It's not to come here and harm you.
Anytime you force someone, like they did in Arizona, to carry their paperwork, it's to remind them every day that they do not belong in your society.
Now that is the sound of fascism beginning here in America.
Doesn't that scare you? Don't you see history repeating itself? That xenophobia and faux populism to get people worked up to attack outsiders.
That is violent rhetoric, and your violent rhetoric translates to violent action. If you don't get that, well, you're either in denial or you know it's true and you just don't want to admit it.
What's the message we're sending to the rest of the world? I mean, give us your poor, you're tired, and we will greatly mistreat them under horrible conditions where some of them will die. That's not what the Statue of Liberty says.
If you asked me to come up with something insulting to Latinos,
yeah.
I couldn't have done anything like this. I wouldn't have thought to insult the Grand Canyon. We're supposed to be the shop where they're unarmed.
Hey, everyone, welcome to Five Things. I'm your host, Kyle Edwards.
Remember great wrestling brothers, like the Hart, the
Hardy,
the McGuire twins, the whole
team. My dad could have stayed in Syria, and he could have been a victim of all this, right?
Today,
and the thought of the United States saying no to Syrian victims, I don't know. It just, it makes me incredibly emotional and incredibly angry because I think it goes against what this country's about.
The fighters, the warriors, the ones who have gone an extra mile in this game, literally,
the longtime superhero in training, former tag team champion, is actually Reigns' older bro.
It's
hard to imagine a pint-sized Roman
getting pushed around the house. But when your brother is a 360-pound man, it's inevitable. Only three sets of brothers have won the Intercontinental Championship. Goldust and Cody Rhodes, Bret and Owen Hart, and Umaga and Rikishi, the Samoan Bulldozer, encouraged Rikishi's twin sons, the Usos, to start a career in sports entertainment, driving them 10 hours to Houston to start training. Uncle Umaga is also the inspiration for their face.
I got a bunch of things to go through.
Brother Love brought a terror to WWE when he led the Undertaker to the ring in 1990. 5 years later, his brother Zip unleashed a different kind of terror as one of the biggest success bodyguards. Thankfully, Zip didn't recruit his brother to be the man, otherwise we might have never been introduced to Sonny.
Oh, James is A, and the correct answer is, of course, B.
One was a Hellraiser who wore giant spikes on his shoulders. The other had a Madison Avenue haircut and wore fine tailored suits. Cobble Brothers Animal of the Legion of Doom and John Laurinaitis of Cable Power couldn't have been more different. They were both road warriors in a sense. One drove around on motorcycles, the other on scooters and skateboards. Of course, Road Dogg is known for teaming with Billy Gunn, but Road Dogg has three brothers who also had careers in sports entertainment, including WCW's mysterious purple and yellow clad Arachnaman. Well, that's our show for today. Next week, we'll look at the surprising last WWE matches of five legends. Until then, I'm Kyle Edwards, and remember, there's no finer way to travel than by scooter.
John Iderola with you. All right, so Hour 2 has a lot of great stories. I did not check TYT Lives during the break.
Can I read some?
Yeah, let's read a few before we get started.
Okay, so most of these are references to the last stories we did, the two police stories. No Cookies says, folks, that throw could have killed her. Can't believe people are laughing. Yeah, I mean, maybe you laugh, at you're drunk, you're laughing when they're like going back and forth. When he slams her, that... If you're a human, how do you laugh? But people do. Let's see. Sean Ferris says, a 94-pound girl in 4-inch heels shoulder-checking you? She probably stumbled, if anything, which is true. And Bob Button says, problem isn't that police withhold video until after investigation is complete. Real problem is no outrage once it does come out.
Right, that's exactly
right. And that is true,
right.
But I think the internet has really helped with that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, people really, when you see footage like that, if you're a human, you want to do something about it, and I think that the internet has been great at that. I mean, these sorts of videos weren't being played on the nightly news a decade ago.
True. Yeah, that video is really difficult to watch, honestly.
That's
just
rough.
This disregard for human life, not only by the cop, but the people that were behind the scenes, either filming it or just laughing at it.
It reminds me of the body slam at the pool party, I believe in Texas.
Yeah.
The guy picked up the girl and just slammed her down. Like, are you a person? Are you a human?
Yeah, I can't deal with it. Okay. Let's move on with some more news. United Airlines is currently in the middle of a PR nightmare after some of their officials decided to drag a passenger off a plane in one of the most violent ways that we've seen on a plane so far. Now, this story really has to do with the fact that airlines have this annoying policy of overbooking flights. And sometimes they'll overbook flights and everyone will show up, and then they have to try to convince passengers to give up their seat in exchange for a voucher. Usually it's like a $400 voucher that goes toward another flight, and then they'll get rebooked onto a later flight. Well, a lot of people book their flights during a specific date and time because they need to get to places. And this is one of the cases where, again, everybody showed up, everyone wanted to fly, and no one wanted to give up their seats. Now, as a result, United decided that they would pick random people and make them give up their seats so they could accommodate the employees and the proper individuals to move ahead with the flight. Now, when that happened, they chose one man who claimed that he was a doctor and that he could not fly at a later time. And so what you're about to see is a difficult video to watch. It's a little graphic, but it features the authorities literally dragging a man off the plane. Take a look. Seat, and apparently they dragged him over the armrest and forced him off the plane.
Threw him down in the aisle.
So there are other videos out there. I want to give credit to the woman who did film this. Her name is Andrea, and she posted it on, Audra Bridges. She posted it on Facebook, and it's been widely shared. But there are other videos.
Yeah, we saw in there, two other people were filming it in that video.
Right. And one of them features a close-up of the passenger and the fact that he was bloody as a result of this confrontation with the authorities. Apparently, in that video, he also said things like, just kill me, that I have to go home. Anyway, it's this whole thing is really frustrating, and it's just devastating because it happens all the time, and even though you're a paying customer and you do everything right and you play by the rules, this could happen to you and you have very little protection, right? Now, the airlines have to compensate you if they have to put you on a later flight and cause this huge inconvenience, but they get to overbook flights all the time because they're like, well, some people don't show up. But you still get paid for that seat. Those people still pay for the flight. You guys never refund. Getting a refund from an airline is one of the hardest things in the world. It's harder than freaking buying a house.
Yeah, even though they will immediately fill that seat with another person.
Of course they will. And so if someone pays for the flight and that seat, who cares if they show up or not? You're still getting your money, right? And so I feel terrible for this guy. I hate that this policy exists. I hate that the airlines get away with it. But United is dealing with a ton of criticism as a result of this situation.
Yeah. It's a perverse situation because we would be up in arms if they overbooked something stupid and cheap like a movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, it's okay for them to overbook something that costs you way, way 30 times more, and that if you can't use the service, your vacation is ruined, you don't get to go to the funeral you were going to, whatever it is. Nobody just gets on a plane because, like, I don't really have anything to do today.
Right.
Everybody desperately needs to finish that flight, so for some reason they can do it there. Now, my first reaction to this was, this is the perfect video summary of the relationship between corporations and regular people in this country.
That's a great point.
That if they want to, they can send in goons, those goons can brutalize you until they get to make a little bit more money. It would be bad enough if they had stopped four people from getting on the plane. But you let them get on the plane. To drag them out? Are you mad? Are you crazy? There's three people, maybe 10 people filming you. You think you can get away with this? And they do think they can get away with it. They think they can just punch us in the face. There's nothing we can do. Well, maybe we can't punch back. We can punch them in the stock. It's going to cost them possibly billions of dollars if the uproar continues. That's the power we have as individuals.
Yes, that is the power that we have as individuals. But you also have to keep in mind that you know, a lot of the big airlines will buy smaller airlines, and then it doesn't create a monopoly per se, but it does lead to way less options when you want to fly. And so there have been multiple instances where I've said, I am never going to fly on this, you know, airline again. And then when I'm booking a flight, and you're right, a lot of times you're booking flights for important reasons, whether it's work-related, family emergencies, things like that. You're booking a flight, you have no options. And then you feel like you have to book with United or whatever it is.
Yeah,
and American. Exactly. And I feel like they're emboldened by that, by knowing that in a lot of cases you can threaten them as much as you want, but you don't have a lot of choices out there. And so this policy, there has to be some regulation to stop it. And if you work for the airlines and you're like, no, people don't show up, I don't care if people don't show up. Okay, think about it in this context. If you buy tickets to go see Drake, right, because that's something that I would do, and you're spending, whatever, hundreds of dollars for that seat, imagine if that venue was like, you know, sometimes people, they just get too drunk before the concert and then they don't show up, so we're gonna triple book each seat. Because we think, I mean, I paid for the ticket. I don't care. Guess what? If I pay the money, it's up to me whether I show up or not, okay? Mm-hmm. But here's the thing. The venue still makes the money. The airline still makes the money, okay?
Drake still makes his money.
Yeah. Exactly. Drake still makes his money.
God, yeah, and by the way, look, are you going to get to the apology? A spokesperson said, we apologize for the overbook situation. That's a terrible apology, but not as bad as when the CEO steps in. That's how big this got. And he said that he apologizes for the re-accommodation situation. Mm-hmm. No, people aren't mad at you because of the re-accommodations. They're mad at you because you guys brutalized a doctor. That's why we're pissed at you, because you threw a guy down and bloodied him and dragged him off like he was a sack of meat. That's what we're mad at you for. And these sorts of statements are why people hate corporations, because they have drained from their spokesperson and from their CEO any trace of humanity or empathy. They become the robots we know they are. And also, by the way, I did some research, and I'm not a lawyer, but I did some research, and apparently a lot of the times when they go and say, okay, we've overbooked, we're going to offer you $400 to get off the flight, a lot of times that is not as much as you can legally get back.
Right.
And it's just in travel vouchers. You're actually supposed to be given cash. When you accept one of those things early on, when they're just like, hey, do we have any volunteers? You're giving up your right to get as much as you're legally owed, which does not have to come in the form of a travel voucher. You can get more cash.
Yeah, exactly. So know your rights and know what you can do to, I mean, you can't really protect yourself. If you find yourself in a situation like this, they can go ahead and kick you off the flight, which is crazy. But I don't know. I don't know if there are any politicians out there that want to, like, reform this or change this, but there needs to be.
Yeah.
And if there are people like that, I mean, they certainly have my attention.
Yeah, so it's not guaranteed, but so we were given a tip by a fan of the show on the carrier that functions as United Express. And we read through their guidelines for these sorts of situations, and there's no references made to forcible evacuation out of the plane, that they can drag you out. It says that they can cancel your ticket, they can refund you. It doesn't say anything about being able to use physical force. And so it's possible that this isn't just bad PR, but they might have literally broken the law. But we're still looking into that.
Yeah. All right, moving on to other news. Over the weekend, 21st Century Fox said that, hey, you know what? We think we're going to go ahead and investigate the sexual harassment claim against Bill O'Reilly. Well, good for you. I mean, he's had some sexual harassment allegations toward him since 2002, but who cares about that? Now, interestingly enough, this statement from Fox happened after a complaint was phoned in to the network's corporate hotline last week by Wendy Walsh, a former regular guest on Fox's The O'Reilly Factor TV show, and her lawyer, Lisa Bloom. Now, it is interesting that they phoned in to the network's hotline, because the network itself kept saying, well, you know, all these women keep making these allegations against Roger Ailes and Bill O'Reilly, but no one called our hotline, right? So I think that Lisa Bloom and Wendy Walsh wanted to make a point about calling the hotline and making a big deal about this, as they should. Now, it is interesting, again, that Fox had no intention of doing a proper investigation until now until this past weekend.
15 years after the beginning of all this?
It's crazy. I mean, they had no problem settling with five different women to the tune of, you know, $13 million and defending Bill O'Reilly in the past, but now all of a sudden they're like, okay, maybe we should get some professionals involved and do an independent investigation of this. Now, as you guys probably already know, a number of advertisers did decide to pull out of the Bill O'Reilly show, and Howard Kurtz is the first Fox News host to even mention any of this on his program. So I want to show you the first clip where he talks about it. Take a look.
This week, more than 50 companies have pulled their advertising from O'Reilly's top-rated cable news program.
So I wanted to show you that clip because...
It's top-rated.
Yeah.
You know that?
It's top-rated. Top-rated. Like, they can't help themselves. Top-rated cable news program. Now, but why is that even relevant to the discussion? They pulled their ads because Bill O'Reilly has been accused by several women who used to work at the network or currently work at the network of sexual harassment. And by the way, for anyone who might, you know, defend him even today because, hey, there's no proof, they settled, so we haven't seen any evidence, keep in mind that in 2004, there was an audio recording of him calling his associate producer, Andrea Macris, and talking about how he wants to, like, rub a soapy loofah all over her body. Later he called it a falafel because, you know, sometimes you work up an appetite when you're sexually harassing someone.
Tasty.
Yeah. And so there's evidence of him doing this in the past. And so it's just crazy to constantly defend him even after that evidence was shown back in 2004. Now, one other quick thing. Let's listen to what Howard Kurtz had to say about Fox's approach to all this.
This has been a difficult and uncomfortable period for the people who work here, no question about it. The network has been trying to move on, to change the culture, and to make clear that any kind of harassment is unacceptable.
It's been a really uncomfortable situation, almost as uncomfortable as a phone call with Bill O'Reilly.
Oh, is this a very difficult time for Howard Kurtz? Are you having a hard time because of these allegations? Oh, your life is very difficult. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
They're trying to change the culture, but they're not really trying to change the culture. I mean, look, they're investigating it now. Yay, that's amazing. What do you think they're going to find? Come on. They settled all those lawsuits. They know what's going on. It's like the Catholic Church in Boston. They know what's happening. They're now investigating because the heat is on them, and as much as they don't want to investigate it, they really don't want an independent investigation of Bill O'Reilly, and so they're going to jump in front of it, and they're going to sweep it under the rug.
Yep.
You can expect that anytime now. And the culture will continue because they're not going to fire Bill O'Reilly.
He's still there. That's the whole point. He's still there. Now, of course, since they're going to launch this independent investigation, O'Reilly also needs to lawyer up. And it is a little ironic who he decided to hire to defend him. Let's go to graphic 7. According to the New York Times, the conservative commentator, who made his name in the 1990s disparaging then-President Bill Clinton for having an extramarital affair, has hired Clinton's lawyer from the embattled Monica Gate era, Mark Fabiani. So, I don't know, ironic, strange, sad. Also,
I mean, he knows a lot about that area of law, I guess.
He does. And then finally, I think the most relevant part of this entire conversation, the fact that his audience continues to support him, and he has experienced a little bit of a ratings boost as a result of this scandal. So not last weekend, but the weekend before, the New York Times published that bombshell report indicating that 21st Century Fox had settled with five different women to the tune of $13 million. All of these women had made similar sexual harassment allegations against Bill O'Reilly. Well, right after that was published, here's what happened with Bill O'Reilly's ratings. Approximately 3.8 million people watched O'Reilly's show on Tuesday. That was the Tuesday after the New York Times published that report. That eclipsed last week, where O'Reilly's top-rated show had only 2.3 million viewers. O'Reilly's Monday and Tuesday shows had a 14% ratings bump from the previous week. Maybe that's the reason why Fox continues to employ him, even though, again, these accusations date back to 2002.
I mean, imagine you're like a kid. Thankfully, a kid doesn't pay attention to politics or to media like Fox News. But, like, you, so if you sexually harass women, perhaps sexually abuse women, what do you get? Well, you can get a huge boost in your ratings, or you can become President of the United States. And I think some people, people who hate Fox News, are going to see this, and they're going to think, maybe not even consciously, mm-hmm. okay, so this is terrible for those women, they're getting sexually harassed. They're conservative women, and they chose to work at Fox News. But, like, we still have human dignity. And think about how allowing this old-school Mad Men culture to continue at Fox News, that doesn't just hurt the employees of Fox News. It hurts their viewers. I mean, they would change if they were forced to. They might become not just more ethical, but better journalists if they weren't holding on to the old ways of doing business.
Right. And I think my past commentary in regard to conservative women makes clear that I don't necessarily fancy them, right? But even with that said, they're humans, and regardless of their political ideology, I will do everything and anything necessary to support and protect them against this type of behavior.
Exactly.
All right, we have to take a break, so tweet to us using the hashtag TYTLive. I will read them and respond to them when we come back. And when we come back, like the most insane Fox News segment, especially in the middle of all this sexual harassment drama. You don't want to miss that and more when we come back.
TYT is unique in a lot of ways.
I'm going to ask some uncomfortable questions.
Right, I feel like I missed out.
So what is going on?
If I don't eat, my head's going to explode.
As I take my shirt off, just goes, is that your body?
Now we move to inappropriate story number two.
I just never felt guilty about masturbation.
It's amazing.
I could take partial credit for opening up your sexuality.
I was a kid in the pool with a shirt off.
Let's just call it what it is. I was that kid.
Well, you deal with the bitch side of that, right? But you're my boss, so that's what happens.
I think we're more likely to They do see it from the frame of the rich and the powerful, and they don't realize it.
The last time that happened, we elected Abraham Lincoln.
I don't know, wouldn't it be wonderful if we unfucked the world?
You and I are disasters.
Don't stereotype all cops, don't stereotype all any blowing up like Dave Kohler on Twitter.
That's pretty good progress.
I didn't know you could leave positive comments. It's a very TYT thing. There's a whole bunch of depressing stuff. So that at the end I can give you a point. Winning is, in terms of change and positive change, is not just possible, it's inevitable.
Great time to be alive.
But burn this mother down. That's what you're saying? Fuck it, let's go do it. And that's why I keep thanking you guys for being members. Because together, we got their attention.
Thanks for tuning in, and as always, stay strong.
Hey, Al, I can't remember. Is there a specific blur we use for Miley Cyrus's butthole? Is it like a Gaussian or a mosaic or a compound?
I just closed my Wells Fargo account.
I just divested funds from Wells Fargo.
I definitely urge you to do the same.
Please come divest. Divest today from all the big banks. Wells Fargo, Bank of America, Citibank, Chase. There are so many others.
Do it. We can make a difference.
Water is life.
Welcome to Nerd Alert, everyone. We have an exciting show for you this week.
Glad to communicate with all the nerds out there.
What's beautiful about geeks is geeks are open to everybody. That's the thing. It's like, so you got your thing, I got my thing. It's like, and if you're not, then you're a bad geek.
Why did you choose Battlestar Galactica? Because it's awesome. No kidding. The floor is not lava. Yucky! Ah, my nightmare! And there's one very special characteristic that many men have been interested in. Penis size. What's up, friend?
Yeah, I know that curve.
And that movie is the Valentine's Day romantic classic, Deadpool.
Whoa, wait a second, Doc. You mean to tell me this is a nerd alert? That's right, Marty, we've entered a nerd alert.
Isn't that right? How can you improve pizza? With math, of course.
If we spilled goldfish crackers on the floor and we didn't want to clean them up, so we thought that if we stomped on them an infinite amount of time, they would mathematically
cease to exist.
We are ready for a Wonder Woman movie. Oh, wait, no, let me correct myself. We were ready for a Wonder Woman movie years ago.
I'm Joss Whedon, and you're watching Nerd Alert.
TYT lives for you. Tanya Pavlova says, okay, so I'm really not going to America until you get your shit together. I think it's a pretty good idea, actually.
Fly a different airline.
Well, also, it's not just about flying here. I mean, right now, tourism in the United States is down pretty significantly since Trump came to office. And it's because of a lot of fear that people have. You know, the TSA screening process, how they want people to unlock their smartphones, you know, some of these, you know, some of the rhetoric geared towards certain individuals of certain religious backgrounds. So I don't blame people for not wanting to come here.
Like, the landmarks of a country are objective, but what you think about that country, the, like, affection you have for that country, that leads people to go to a city or not to go to a city or a country or whatever. Like,
yeah.
People just find America noticeably more distasteful now. And can we really blame them?
Yeah, I don't blame them at all. It's one of the reasons why I don't have interest in going to places like Dubai, right? Mm-hmm. It's just I don't really want to risk it. I know that most people go there and they travel and they don't have any problems, but some people get caught up in some drama that, you know, I don't want to get caught up in. So I don't blame anyone for feeling a little uncomfortable or weary about coming here to the United States for tourism reasons. Art Murray says, I noticed he wasn't a first-class passenger in regard to the guy who was dragged off the flight. Yeah, I also noticed
that. They're not going to do that to a first class. Yeah, it's like cops. It's like Michael Moore's Cops, but with CEOs. Like, nah, they don't get treated like that.
Yeah, it's pretty sad. All right, moving on to some other news. In the midst of all these sexual harassment allegations toward Bill O'Reilly, and after Roger Ailes was pretty much forced to resign because he was dealing with sexual assault and sexual harassment allegations, Fox thought it would be a great idea to host a segment featuring women in tight dresses who give us advice on how to clean our homes. Take a look.
It's time to freshen up, and we've got some tips to spring clean, make your spring cleaning a breeze, like using a lint roller to clean your lamp.
Oh. Okay, so, I don't know if you guys
noticed. I am going to try that, though.
I don't know if you guys noticed, okay, so first of all, I don't know why we ever need to have segments teaching people how to clean, but it's especially...
I get it. I think it's fine.
No. It's supposed to be a news network, right? Why is this on a news network? And, like, I can't... I understand if it's, like, a morning show, right? Like,
it
Regis
is,
and Kelly or whatever that show is.
It's for the morning show.
Right.
But it's a preview for the Saturday morning show.
No, I don't care. I don't care. It's supposed to be Fox News, which I know that they don't really do news. I get that. But I just feel like these cleaning segments overall annoy me.
So you're saying that, like, I can't pitch, like, we close out the show today with, like, me showing you how to make, like, a nice lasagna or something like that?
Well, you're Italian, so you should teach us how to make a spicy meatball.
Yeah.
Okay.
I get what you're saying. It's news. They're trying to be, like, that part of it bothers me so much less than everything else.
No, I get it.
Especially because I don't really know how to clean.
That's my one nitpicky comment that we, you know, focus on way too much. But the other thing I wanted to mention, and we have more content to show you guys from the segment. The other thing that I noticed was the song that they were playing in the background. Okay. It's that Yakety Yak song.
Yakety Yaks.
Whatever.
Why are they playing that?
Okay, so for those of you who don't know what the lyrics are, I would like to recite them to you. Are you prepared?
Okay.
Take out the papers and the trash, or you don't get no spending cash. If you don't scrub that kitchen floor, you ain't gonna rock and roll no more. Yakety Yak, don't talk back. Oh, what an appropriate song.
Oh, you were right about the title, by the way. I was thinking of something else.
Yeah, I was like, Yakety Sax.
That's a different song.
You don't know.
That's Benny Hill, yeah. Anyway.
Okay,
so the lyrics, again, a little bit misogynistic.
Okay, so they're wearing tight dresses, they're bending over. That's Abby Huntsman, bending over, cleaning, pretending to clean.
They chose
whatever.
Them randomly. It could have been Greg Gutfeld. You don't know.
Why would you do this segment while you guys are dealing with serious issues pertaining to sexual harassment? I don't know.
Because
maybe
that's all they have
that's
is
all
the
they
network.
Have. And also, nothing but, like, men in their 70s watch Fox News, right? Why would you think that they would have any interest in learning how to clean? It's because they don't. They have a lot of interest in seeing young women in tight dresses bending over as they're pretending to clean. Anyway.
The number one thing a 72-year-old white man wants is Abby Huntsman bending over while cleaning. That is the only thing, maybe a Werther's original. Those are the two things that they want in their day, and you can only give them one through the TV, so they give them the Abby Huntsman.
There is almost nothing I enjoy more than a random Werther's original when I'm visiting, like, a relative's home. I love Werther's. They're so good. Okay, but anyway, that was not a sponsored ad. Okay, so I want to show you a little bit more because I think this next clip will kind of give you a sense of why the segment continues to be a little problematic. You're going to hear from host Clayton Morris in the background. Not even in the background. He's in the video. Pay very close attention to what he says. Take a look.
Guys, I know you're thrilled about all of these.
Yes, yeah, I'm excited to watch. I'm excited to watch you do it. All right, now with the carpet.
Oh, the look. Does it match the? Oh, sorry, I'm gonna be fired because I'm not famous yet. The way he looked at you was like, oh, can we
watch
can
it one more time?
Can actually look at that guy's face.
Look at
guys. I know you're thrilled about all of these.
Yes, yeah, I'm excited to watch. I'm excited to watch you do it. All right, now with the carpet.
He wanted a wink. Oh. I think his hands were in his pockets. Don't do that. You're on TV. Get your hands out of your pockets. For me, the reason I really don't like this is specifically because it's Fox News, and as you say, they're embroiled in sexual harassment charges right now. They should know better, considering the things we know that they already do on a daily basis. If it wasn't Fox News, it would bother me 80% less, because I think, I don't know Abby Huntsman, I don't even know who that other woman is, because I don't watch Fox, but you know what it's like when you do the same show day after day and you're sitting there. I mean, granted, they're sitting there in dresses with a camera on their legs and everything, but it's still just sitting there. You want to get up and you want to do something fun and different. So maybe doing a little bit of cleaning or showing something. Some people are really enthusiastic about cleaning.
I know. Look,
but it's Fox.
It's about the context of the situation. It's not just, oh, they decided to do something different and fun and we're giving them a hard time about it. It's about this consistent stereotyping and belittling and minimizing of women in these types of roles, right? The sexual harassment allegations, the sexual assault allegations, the constant stereotyping, like you put all of that together and you have a more, I guess, contextual idea of what they think of women, how they treat women, the type of environment that they're working in. And look, they've decided to take this job. They decided to agree to doing this segment. There's no way I would ever agree to that segment, especially in that company, right? And also, if Cenk brought it up, can you imagine Cenk bringing that up? Like, Anna, let's...
Can you bend a little bit as you're doing it?
Can you wear a tight dress and pretend like you're dusting the table as you're bending? Like, I just can't fathom it.
Yeah.
And so it's just, it really stood out to me.
The only other point I want to make, the reason that this may seem like a ridiculous thing, we like it for the purposes of joking, but also there are larger implications, as you got into, in terms of holding women back. But especially for the viewers, the way they portray race, the way they portray gender and gender roles, I don't think that creates new generations of racists or misogynists, because no young people watch Fox News.
Mm-hmm.
But some of those people who are 70 or 80 now, over the past 10, 20 years, would have evolved and would have changed if Fox News wasn't stopping them from doing that by reinforcing their mind that the way things used to be, that was the right way. Yeah. And women should have remained like that, and racial minorities should still know their place. And it got them to hold on to those disgusting views longer than they otherwise would have. And that's why segments like this are actually incredibly damaging.
Absolutely. All right. Well, we go from Fox News stereotyping women to a province in Canada protecting them. So I want to do a little bit of international news. I think this is some positive news to share with you guys. British Columbia has decided to make it illegal for places of work to require women to wear certain footwear, heels. So apparently some companies, as part of their dress code, could force female employees to wear heels, but it turns out that a politician kind of took the lead in making this illegal, and now as a result, BC government has created an amendment to the footwear rules under the province's 1996 Workers' Compensation Act that will essentially give women the right to wear whatever footwear they decide is appropriate and comfortable and safe. So the BC Green Party leader, Andrew Weaver, filed a private members' bill in March designed to prevent employers from setting varying footwear and other requirements based on gender, gender expression, or gender identity. It's weird because since, you know, I'm in my own bubble here at a very progressive company, I never even really considered, you know, corporations, companies, whatever it is, any place of work requiring women to wear heels, because the reality is heels are kind of unsafe, very bad for your body. I love heels. I wear them on a regular basis anyway, but that's because I do it based on free will. But for women who don't want to wear it, they shouldn't be pressured or forced to do so.
So if Cenk said you have to wear heels from now on, what would your response be?
I just can't imagine it. But
can't imagine it either. You guys don't even know if we're wearing pants right now. Why would we have to wear a particular type of shoes? I can just take my shoes off. I should, actually. I'd be more comfortable on the show. I might start doing that. I can't believe that in... It'll be fine. I'll put on my socks. I don't know. I can't believe that. I mean, I would be surprised if in the U.S. this was legal. I guess maybe it is. But the fact that in Canada, supposedly a far more progressive country, especially on gender and workers' rights, the idea that even in one area this was possible, that you would, why wouldn't there be a huge outcry? I know that in some limited circumstances there were.
I used to work at, one of my first jobs while I was in college was at a car dealership, and I worked as a receptionist, and my higher up in the company had been very clear about what she expects from her girls. She would always call us her girls. And so she made it clear to me that I was not to show up to work without makeup on. Mm. That even if I was running late, I had to, in the very least, apply lipstick. And I was so young, so at that time I was just like, oh, okay, it's just, you know, she just wants me to look good and not show up in my pajamas or something like that. But then I really thought about it, and look, there are certain standards regarding our appearance that we have to deal with that guys don't have to deal with. And this is not me, like, oh, bitching and moaning, like, oh, it's so unfair. I like wearing makeup. I have no problem with it. But understand that that is a resource, right? That is something that you have to spend a lot of money on.
Yeah.
And so if you are forced to wear makeup or you're forced to dress a certain way, to buy heels, it's a costly part of being a woman who's employed for various companies, right? And so it's also unfair. It's like this notion that if you're a dude, since society doesn't expect you to wear makeup, you're totally fine. You look great without makeup, right? Because that's what society expects of you. For women, if you don't wear makeup, well, then you're a slob.
Yeah.
And so that's unfair, too. There are lots of women out there who are just insanely beautiful. Even if you're not beautiful, why are you forced to wear makeup?
Mm-hmm.
So this kind of stuff does happen. It's just that I don't think most people really talk about it or even acknowledge it.
Yeah, and I would imagine that even in the area where you previously could legally require women to wear them, I doubt many businesses would do that. Because it seems like you're just asking for some sort of suit to try to get the law changed or something like that. It seems crazy. I don't know why you would care. I know there are jobs like Hooters has very specific uniform standards, maybe something like where you're a receptionist, they might expect a little bit to see the front face or something like that, but yeah, most men never have to deal with anything like this. Like, I guess you could be a huge slob maybe, but the standard would be so different, and I think that we have to move past it. I mean, if it would bother you that you stop women from wearing heels. Like, if you found out that women weren't allowed to show their toes in some country, then it should also shock you that it was legal to make women do it.
Exactly. All right, switching gears a little bit to a completely different topic. The heroin epidemic continues to be a huge problem in various states, and of course there are elected officials and members of police departments that are trying to grapple with it, find ways to solve the problem, and go after the right people in order to lower the number of overdoses. Well, there is one sheriff in Florida who went about it in a little bit of a questionable way. It's Sheriff Peyton Grinnell, and he is at the Lake County, in Lake County, Florida, I should say. And so he puts out this video, and a lot of people are like, what are you doing? What is this? Okay, take a look.
I'm Lake County Sheriff Peyton Grinnell. Over the last month or so, I've had several phone calls from citizens in this county concerned about the number of overdoses related to heroin. I want our citizens to know that I am aware of this serious issue. I am asking our residents to please call and let us know if you know of a location that this poison is being pushed out to our streets. You can remain anonymous. To the dealers that are pushing this poison, I have a message for you. We're coming for you. As a matter of fact, our undercover agents have already bought heroin from many of you. We are simply awaiting the arrest warrants to be finalized. So, to the dealers, I say, enjoy looking over your shoulder, constantly wondering if today's the day. We come for you. Enjoy trying to sleep tonight, wondering if tonight's the night our SWAT team blows your front door off the hinges. We are coming for you. If our agents can show the nexus between you, the pusher of poison, and the person that overdoses and dies, we will charge you with murder. We are coming for you. Run.
What?
And then, like, he, like, looks at the guy behind the camera, and the guy behind the camera's like,
nailed it! Did that just, that was real. That was,
yeah.
That was a real video that was meant to be taken seriously. So, a number of people on this police department's Facebook page have compared it to an ISIS video. One person said that they were expecting the sheriff to, this is not funny, but it was an interesting comment, to behead someone with a dull knife.
Oh, God.
It was such a strange video. I don't know what he was thinking, and this is not how you tackle a heroin epidemic. It shows a fundamental misunderstanding. Exactly.
That's how Batman does it. Through utilizing fear.
There's so much to comment.
Are you saying you disagree with Batman?
Maybe not. Maybe not. Maybe Batman is right. Maybe he's the arbiter.
Peyton Grinnell, Dark Knight. Maybe not.
There's so much to comment on. Okay, so first of all...
Yeah, and there's obviously a serious side that we'll get to. But it is laughable.
Yeah, like the fact that he doesn't look at the camera at all because he's reading something. He's reading the script on the side. And then at one random moment, it just like starts zooming in.
At a random moment.
Be afraid.
I have a message for you. Then zoom in on me when I say I have a message for him. I have a message for you.
Yeah.
Just the music in the background.
Can we play the video as B-roll as we comment on it? Because I have a lot of things to say.
They definitely have they look kind of badass.
No,
like, when you cover someone's face and you put a vest on them.
Sure, I guess, I think the one who's closest to the sheriff on the left-hand side probably looks the most badass. The one on the far left looks like a joke. Why is he wearing, his eyes are complete, why is he wearing sunglasses? His eyes are already completely covered.
Okay.
This is absurd.
They filmed this during a short break while skiing. And so he wanted to be protected from the elements. I don't know why I didn't cover his hands.
This is crazy. And also, I think that you guys could probably notice that it seems as though the sheriff is giddy at the idea of knocking down someone's door and raiding them in the middle of the night.
We've covered some of those.
We've covered a lot of those drug raids, which usually end, not usually, but a lot of them end up with a family pet getting killed.
A lot of dogs.
Them showing up in the wrong home.
Killing the wrong person.
Throwing a hand grenade in a baby's crib. We did that story, a couple years ago. And so it's like this weird power trip that you notice with some cops, and I feel like it's displayed in this video. Look, the heroin epidemic is serious, and we need to find solutions for it. This is not the right solution. Opioid deaths have quadrupled since 1999. There were 33,091 deaths in 2015 alone. There was a 22.7% increase in overdoses in Florida, okay, from 2014 to 2015. So these are cops from Florida. They understand that it's a serious problem. They want to tackle it. I respect them for that. But this video is both comical and also shows, again, a fundamental misunderstanding of how to solve the problem.
Yeah. Yeah, the only way that I won't criticize them is that I get that at core, they see the damage that heroin is doing and they want to do something about it. And I have produced a lot of cheesy videos. And so I understand that you go into a project thinking this is going to be badass. Mm-hmm. But then it turns out that even though you and your friend are lightsaber fighting to the best of your abilities, it doesn't look that cool a couple years later. So I know what that's like. But everything else beyond that, it's not just comical. It is comical. Like, I love the one guy who is like, no, the glasses are too much. I'm not putting on the glasses. I respect that guy. But there's the dark side, too, where, okay, so you think you're just trying to terrorize the drug dealers, but you're sending that out to everybody who lives in the area where you work. Like, you're trying to terrorize the population. And you're not supposed to be a terrifying force. You're supposed to be a stabilizing force, someone we can rely on and trust. You're not supposed to look like special forces. Nobody except cops likes the gigantic influx of military-grade equipment and how badass it looks. Cops love that. I get it. The weapons are cool. But the people don't like that. The people want you to be a regular guy, walking the beat, maybe you have a sidearm, you protect us. And the idea that you're going to hunt down and scare the drug dealers like Batman, that you're going to kick down the door, like, do you not follow how often that ends tragically? That it ends in the loss of life, innocent life, or just effing drug dealers? Because drug dealers are bad people in some cases, but they're not rapists, they're not murderers. They're people who are selling something you disagree with that very well might be legal in a couple of years. It's not a military problem. It's a problem of public health.
Yeah.
It's a problem, perhaps, of education.
Yeah, that's a great point.
You're not supposed to sneak up behind someone and shoot them in the back of the head. That is exactly the wrong way to approach the drug problem.
Absolutely.
And that guy's not 70. He's relatively young. He just became sheriff. I looked it up. This is a terrible precedent to set.
Oh, he just became sheriff?
Yes.
Oh.
And so he wants to look badass. And look, again, you can't discount the role of social media and the internet. Like, they think, look, maybe we can get a little bit of press. Maybe I could become governor on this thing. I'm not going to speak for the guy, but I don't like the incentives to try to terrorize the people that you're supposed to be serving. We know where this road leads in America, and it leads towards dead civilians.
Absolutely, and I think that it's important to find solutions by using tactics other than fear. You don't want your people in your county to fear you. You want them to trust you, and when you present yourself as some sort of like crazy military dude who's like
vigilante,
giddy at the notion of like knocking down your door in the middle of the night, like that. I think that creates a certain level of fear and distrust toward you that you're not even necessarily wanting.
Yeah.
So just keep all of that in mind as well. Again, the heroin epidemic is devastating, and I think that a lot of people who maybe don't watch, you know, in-depth news about it don't understand where it comes from, how it started, how pharmaceutical companies are involved. Like, you want to talk about pushers. You want to talk about pushers, okay? The real pushers are the pharmaceutical companies.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the criminal behavior is always geared toward those who are in the worst position in their lives. And I'm not trying to make excuses for drug dealers. I think that the traffickers do need to be targeted to some extent. But again, this is not the right way to go about it.
Yeah, and if you were to legalize it, you'd eliminate a lot of this ancillary illegal behavior surrounding the drug trade.
Exactly. All right, moving on. More than 400 construction companies have submitted plans and ideas for the design of Donald Trump's border wall. Now, to give you a better sense of what the requirements are, rules state that the wall must be tough enough to withstand attacks from sledgehammer, car,
sledgehammer, car jack, pickaxe, chisel, battery-operated impact tools, propane or butane, or other similar handheld tools for up to 4 hours, but also be aesthetically pleasing. Now, it has to be aesthetically pleasing on the U.S. side. They don't care too much about what it looks like on the Mexican side. But it is interesting that it must be physically imposing in height, ideally 30 feet, but the terms also state that shorter options of 18 feet might be or may be acceptable, okay? Another thing that they kind of conceded on was that a second request for proposals was published with an option for the design to have a see-through component, which means it might just be like a mesh fence, because this is expensive.
I thought it meant like a porthole or something.
No.
So you can like peek through and see if anyone's coming.
No, I think they're trying to make an exception because they realize that this is an insanely expensive project that Mexico is not going to pay for, U.S. taxpayers are going to pay for, so maybe we'll just come up with like a mesh fence situation, and then that's it. All right, so let me give you some of the proposals and some of the ideas. It involves drones and toxic moats. It's craziness, okay? I just want you to know where your taxpayer money is going to go. So Clayton Industries of Pittsburgh have proposed digging a 100-foot trench along the border and filling it with nuclear waste. A flimsy chain-link fence will run along the Mexican side, followed by a field of motion sensors. If any plucky border jumpers make it past the toxic trench, they'll be met with another 30-foot wall the other side. Okay. So that's just one of the proposals. And they're like, I wouldn't call it toxic waste. They called it something else.
It's a 100-foot trench?
Yeah.
Do they have any idea how wide that is? You know how much toxic waste you would need?
I mean, I'm pretty sure that we can
generate it.
Yeah, exactly.
We'll 100 feet of toxic waste?
Yeah.
By the way, the people who talk about the border wall almost universally have never been near the border. Because we just showed you some people's houses are going to be on the southern side of it because it has to cut across U.S. land. It's not, they think it's just 100 miles from anything. People's property's right there.
Yeah.
They don't want 100 feet of toxic waste on the other side of a concrete wall from their property. That's bad for property values.
Yeah. Now, again, keep in mind that so far, you know, around 400 companies have submitted design ideas. So just because we're explaining what one of the ideas are doesn't mean that this is what they're going to do. But it kind of gives
you
a sense.
No 100-foot trench.
Who knows? I mean, it's Trump. So he might go for, like, the craziest proposal. But this is also a very...
Well, I would actually like to make a recommendation, if that's okay.
Sure.
I previously had no experience in the real estate industry, but that's okay. Jared Kushner got to start off without knowing what he's doing. So I would like to make a bid. So nuclear waste, you're not going to be able to get that much nuclear waste. So I don't know if you're going to be able to see this, but I'll explain it. So it starts off with a gigantic spinning meat grinder. And so as you walk towards it, you just get ground up, and then it deposits the meat on the other side for wild animals. Every once in a while, the TNT under the meat grinder will explode in case anyone is meat grinder-proof. Then there's the 30-foot wall guarded by Godzilla. So Godzilla patrols.
I wish you guys could see this drawing.
And he occasionally shoots fire and acid. It's an upgraded Godzilla if it's in the budget. Maybe we just do fire. And then just in case you get past Godzilla, Gandalf will stop you from passing in the fashion he has traditionally been associated with.
You have to take a photo of
that. So if a Balrog tries to get into the U.S. through the southern border, I think we got this shut locked down.
You have to take a photo of that drawing and then send it to me so I can post it on my Instagram where you guys can see it at Anna Kasparian Official.
Or at Johnny Roll.
Yeah, just say.
It's expensive, but I think we can do it.
It looks really good.
$20 billion.
I like how creative it is.
Thank you.
Now let me give you some other serious proposals.
I don't know what the fuck that's supposed to mean.
No, you know what?
Is this not serious? Okay, what do we got? What do we got? What's serious?
So Dark Pulse Technologies proposes a big ballistic-grade concrete wall embedded with special sensors in order to notify border agents of the exact location of any tampering in real time. In keeping up with their Marvel Comics identity, their wall would be coded to prevent the use of grappling hooks.
Both of those are good ideas.
Yeah, I mean, that's not the craziest,
sensors,
right?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
So I want to be fair to some of the companies with their design ideas, because not all of them are insane. Black Security Products of Austin, Texas has incorporated 4-inch holes in the bottom of the wall to allow animals to scamper across the border undetected, along with riprap system, a riprap system, of loose rocks so the smaller creatures can creep through the wall.
I don't know what that means.
So the reason why I brought this one up is because some of the construction companies are actually rather liberal when it comes to things like the environment. And so in this case, they're sense. Like, we're worried about the animals. We want, animals are innocent, you know? So
that's a serious concern.
Yeah, you know, we don't want Mexican people to come to the country. We want Mexican animals to come
Very
in.
Small Mexican people, theoretically. I don't know what a riprap system is, but yes, you do have to account for the fact that you'd be massively messing up with migration patterns of animals.
Yes, exactly. So, look.
If you cared about that.
And I do, but I don't think someone like Donald Trump does.
No, that's what I'm saying.
You know, of the proposals that I've mentioned to you, I seriously think that the most appealing would be the first one for Donald Trump, the one involving toxic waste.
Mm-hmm. So you didn't see, but I saw a one that was a 30-foot wall. It's pink because he swore it would be big and beautiful. So we're going to make it big and beautiful. It's going to be pink. It's going to be really big. And it's got stairs on the north side so that curious Americans could get up and, like, look over the side at Mexico to see what has become of that wasteland. And there's a mall built into it, a gigantic mall.
Right.
So that would be pretty cool. And so obviously they're mocking the entire idea. But I saw that there was one that was just trees with hammocks. The whole thing would just be trees with a million hammocks.
I mean,
thousands of miles.
I totally get behind that.
Yeah.
I mean, that might be a resort destination.
That's pretty good, yeah.
Yeah.
And someone wanted to make the entire thing out of solar panels.
Oh, that's I did see that. Cool. Yeah. So again, the solar panel idea is another example of them wanting to, you know, be green in building this wall.
I'm going to incorporate that because I think that Godzilla could absorb the solar energy if necessary. I think that's an innovation that will go into phase two.
So we'll see what happens. Again, this is something that we as U.S. taxpayers will have to pay for, and it's a stupid idea. Regardless of what the design decision is, it's a stupid idea, it's a devastating idea, and we'll see how it all plays out. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. If you're a member, stick around because there will be a post-game show for you where I will share a recent experience and exchange that I had with a troll, and I will also ask you for some advice. Mm-hmm. And Jake will be gone for...
And I'm going to briefly explain why I am suddenly deathly afraid of bears. I'll explain that in the post-game because I alluded to it earlier.
All right, guys. We got to go. We love you. We will see you tomorrow.